Let's take a look at Nikon's newest Z70-200mm f2.8 VR, which is Nikon's first telephoto zoom ever for their newest Z series of mirrorless cameras, which is about time because these cameras have been out for a year and a half. On the other hand, we can use the FTZ to use the perfectly good 70-200mm f2.8 VR FL that came out a couple of years ago. What's new about this new Z version of the lens is that it focuses to 0.5 meters at the 70mm end and only 1 meter at the 200mm end, which makes it the world's closest focusing 70-200mm lens, which in and of itself is a wonderful thing. Now, the actual macro ratio, in other words, how large a magnification you get focusing closely, isn't any different than any of the other lenses. They're all about 1:5 or 1:4. This lens is only 1:5, meaning you can get a shot about something about this big full frame. So that isn't any different, but a huge benefit is that now when things are getting closer to you, especially in news and action and anything else, you have a much larger envelope of things you can photograph because they can get closer to you instead of being out at, say, 1.5 meters or 2 meters with the other lenses. You can get down to 0.5 meter at 70 millimeters or 1 meter at 200 millimeters, which is a godsend. And that is the main reason to go buy this lens. Yes, it is extraordinarily sharp. It is the sharpest 70-200 or 80-200 Nikon has ever made. But you'll only see that difference on test charts and in Nikon's own modulation transfer function graphs. Honestly, in pictures, you'll never see a difference because every f2.8, 80-200, or 70-200mm lens Nikon has ever made, and they've been selling these since 1983, has been incredibly sharp. The subtle differences between them will never be visible at actual photographs. In fact, I have a guest here today in the studio. This is an original 1980s Nikon 80-200mm f2.8 AIS. This beast was the world's first. It is only manual focus. This came out long before autofocus. And this is fully compatible. In fact, you can use a $10 adapter ring or the FTZ and shoot this on your Z cameras. Now, this particular lens here is a very valuable classic. You really wouldn't want to get one of these. You'd want to get one of the AFS lenses that will autofocus on your FTZ. But the point is, all of Nikon's 80-200mm and 70-200mm f2.8 zooms have been incredibly sharp. This one is no exception. They had prototypes back in 1978. This lens was on sale since 1983 and is still an incredibly sharp lens, as is the Z camera lens. So let's get that out of the way, as we already did. There's no reason to buy that lens just because you want sharper. Yes, it is sharper, but you won't see the difference in sharpness in actual shooting. You'd need a laboratory test chart to see that. The new Nikon Z lens is also designed for optical perfection. That's why it's not small. The Canon lens is also optically incredible. It's Canon 70-200mm f2.8 RF lens for their mirrorless cameras, but it's much shorter and lighter, which it also focuses super close. To be honest, this new Nikon lens isn't saving you anything. In fact, it's even a little longer and a little heavier than their fluorite 70-200mm f2.8 for their digital single lens reflex cameras. Also new in the 70-200 is Nikon's first use of an SR, or short wavelength refractive optical glass element, which is unique in helping the Nikon reduce the amount of spherochromatism, which is a fancy word for saying that the backgrounds tend to have green fringes on bright objects that are out of focus, and the foregrounds tend to have magenta fringes on objects that are out of focus. Nikon also introduced this SR element in their new 120-300mm lens announced on the same day in 2020. Also new on this telephoto zoom is a tiny little display, similar to the one on the 24-70mm f2.8, that shows basics like aperture or depth of field or focus distance. Also great about this new Z lens is it has programmable function buttons. You can program the ones on the front to do one thing and the one on the back to do something else. So that is always a handy thing to have as well. Also, this new Z lens has a third programmable ring close in to the lens mount that we can program for aperture, exposure compensation, ISO, or nothing. Nikon claims minimal focus breathing. That means when you're photographing a movie, that as the lens is focused from near to far between two different actors, the image doesn't grow or contract, which makes it look like it's breathing. That's a very common thing to happen in lenses. And although Nikon has claimed this for some other lenses before, it's not always true. So we'll see. They claim the new lens is weather sealed. They also claim this new lens has vibration reduction rated to 5.5 stops of improvement, which is Nikon's greatest amount of improvement ever claimed. What's bad about this lens is it's still big, heavy, and expensive, just like all the other professional. This is the biggest and heaviest, and this lens was super expensive. This lens cost about 4 times what a Nikon Nacht cost back when this came out back in 1983. What's missing on this new lens, however, is no vibration reduction switch. of course, the vibration reduction switch I consider very important because if it's not on the lens, I don't have the time to go in the menus and turn it on and off if I'm suddenly on a tripod for something. That may seem a little strange that when I'm on a tripod, I'm in a rush. But guess what? Life waits for no one. And when I'm on a tripod, the light's changing and I don't have the time to go looking for this garbage in menus when I have a shot to shoot. So I want that on my lens, but too bad. The good news is most of the vibration reduction systems today are smart enough that when it detects you're on a tripod, it just shuts them off anyway. This new Z lens only works on Nikon's newest Z cameras, which as of 2020, when I write this, that's only the Z6 and Z7 full-frame cameras or the Z50 DX camera. Nikon calls this the Nikkor Z, 70-200mm f2.8 VRS. Z, of course, stands for the Z mirrorless cameras. VR is vibration reduction, and S means absolutely nothing other than it's the higher-end line of cameras, and it's a subliminal use of the letter S, much like cars are always called ES or SE or EX. It all means sex. Quite read Wilson Brian Key's book on subliminal seduction from the 1970s, and you'll read all about that, why all of these electronic products and camera products mysteriously have X's and E's and S's, kind of like the Tesla S, Tesla Model X, and the Model 3, which was going to be called the Model E, but the Tesla somehow was slapped around and I had to call the Model E the Model 3. But it's all the same thing. It means nothing, actually, in terms of features on this Nikon lens. Some other things it has a stepper motor, which Nikon calls AFP on some of their other lenses. It has Arneo coat, which is a new mysterious magical anti-reflection coating, as well as a nano coating, which gives us less coasts and reflections. It has a spherical elements, which is pretty insane for telephoto lens of moderate speed. It has D, coupling of distance for matrix metering. It has an electronic diaphragm, as do all the Z lenses today. It is ED, which is extra low dispersion glass, along with the fluorite for better optical performance. It has no aperture ring, so it's a G or gelded lens. It has internal focusing, it's an IF lens. And it takes 77mm filters. If we look at the optics in more detail here, the blue elements are conventional optical glass. The gold elements are the Magic ED glass. The deep magenta or purple elements are fluorite, which is a magical substance, which admittedly Canon has been using since the 1970s to make their best lenses, and Nikon only recently has gotten around to doing. The pink element is the SR, short wavelength refractive element, and the green elements are a spherical. It has 21 elements in 18 groups. Six of these, as I've just showed, are ED, one fluorite, one SR, two a spherical. It also has Nikon's super integrated coating, which is the multi-coating they started using back in the 1960s or 70s. And it has a fluorine coating only on the front. So if you don't use a filter, I always use filter. Here's a 95mm filter for this beast here, the original manual focus, an original Nikon 95mm L37 ultraviolet filter. This new lens has a standard 77mm filter thread. It doesn't take 95. The new lens has 9 blades, which are rounded. And it stops down to f22. No news there. I have a complete comparison of every Nikon f2.8 telephoto zoom 80-200 and 70-200 ever made ever since 1978 at this link here. I also have it on my website, which is where that link goes. So you can read about all these lenses in explicit details. This is just the latest of a long family of historic lenses. This lens comes with an HB92 hood. It comes with a CLC3 case. And the tripod collar comes off. It's 3.5 inches in diameter by 8.7 inches extension from the flange. In other words, this is the flange right here. This is the rest of the lens that pokes out behind the flange, but the flange is what mounts and how far it pokes out from the camera. That's 8 or 9 millimeters in diameter and 220 millimeters extension from the flange for this new lens. This new lens is an internal zoom, so it doesn't change length as it is zoomed. The weight is 50.8 ounces or 1440 grams or 3.17 pounds with the tripod collar. Pull the collar off, and it's 48.0 ounces, or 1,360 grams, or 3 pounds on the nose. It was announced on the 5th of January, 2020, and it's promised for February of 2020. It's Nikon model number 20091. At an introduction, the price is $2,597, actually asked at the real dealers. If we compare it, let's compare it to the DSLR 70-200 2.8, and since I'm here, let's compare it to Canon's extraordinary 70-200mm f2.8, which is actually significantly smaller. These pictures are a little bit to scale, but not perfectly. Of course, this Nikon lens is the most recently introduced. The Canon lens is already in people's hands shooting. It claims that I wouldn't put too much faith in these. It claims the most image stabilization of all of these. It has the closest focus distance at 70mm. However, the Canon lens has the same close focus distance at 70 and 200mm. This lens can't focus as close as the Canon lens does at 200mm. The Canon lens has a little bit greater macro power. This lens has a little bit of the least macro power, but unless you're always shooting really close, I wouldn't worry about it. And if you are, The AFD Nikon 70-180mm macro is actually the world's closest focusing. What's missing in this lens is it doesn't have the A/M and M/A modes, which are simply slightly different versions of how sensitive the camera is to manual focus ring motion. I wouldn't worry about that. There's no VR switch on this new Nikon lens. I think that's a big flaw. All three of these lenses have focus limiters, which I never use, but that means you can prevent the lens from focusing too closely if it's accidentally focusing too closely. They all take 77mm filters. I didn't happen to have Canon's MTF grasp, but you'll notice there's a slight difference, a slight improvement with this new Z lens over the FL lens for the DSLRs. But to be honest, although they're easy to see here on the curves, you're never going to see that in actual shooting. They're all about the same outside diameter. This new Z lens is the longest. The Nikon DSLR lens is a little bit shorter, but once you put an FTZ adapter on there, it comes out to be about the same. And the Canon lens is significantly shorter. The Canon lens weighs significantly less. This new Z lens weighs just a little bit more than the DSLR lens. And the prices are all pretty equally very, very high. And as the months go on, these prices will change. There won't be one obvious winner all the time. This is easy to recommend. If you want a telephoto zoom for your Z camera and don't mind the heavy weight, by all means, this is your lens. If you already own a DSLR 80-200 or 70-200, then you might want to use it on an adapter. Specifically, if you want autofocus, only the AFS lenses will do that on the FTZ. However, if you've already got one of the 70-200 2.8s, I would just get the FTZ and be a happy camper. I don't see any real compelling reason to get this new lens unless you really need to focus more closely. And that's it. I recommend using an ultraviolet filter. I always use ultraviolet filters on my lens. I don't use caps because this way, when I put the ultraviolet filter on my lens, it goes in my bag this way. When I pull it out, I'm ready to get up and shoot. I don't have to futz around with a cap. Or for instance, how many times has this happened to you? You put the camera up to your thing, you're ready to shoot, and you're looking through the cap. Then you got to get the cap off. Maybe you missed your picture. You shoot as much as I do. This is a big difference. So I never use a cap. I use clear filters. There's some people that used to sell them as opti caps, meaning optical glass caps, meaning you can just shoot right through them. But again, that's my preference. Filters last a lifetime, so you might as well get the best as well. And that's it. I've linked to the recommended stores where I get these. I would never buy a lens this exotic at retail. Do not ever buy at your local store, because your local store, there's no seal on this box. If you buy something like a doorbell camera, it's wrapped in plastic. You know if it's been opened and screwed around with. This lens, Nikon does not seal the boxes, which I consider to be negligent, because there's no way when you buy it, you can tell if it's still a new lens or if the salespeople have taken it out and shot it or if it was returned from another customer. So don't ever buy it retail. I only buy online. I've been buying online or by telephone order from these stores in New York since the 1970s when they opened. And the reason for that is all this gear is kept in a separate warehouse where the salesmen don't have any ability to get to it off-site, so it ships directly to you and nobody else is fuddled around with your equipment. Especially with an exotic lens like this, you don't want something that somebody's taken out and oops, dropped it, and then returned it and then resold to somebody else. Don't ever buy retail. In any case, I hope you found this helpful. Thanks again for watching Ken Rockwell, kenrockwell.com and kenrockwell.tv.